Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be back here in the Wigmore Hall tonight. That wonderful motet by Clemens Nonpapa, like all of tonight's music, takes its text from the Old Testament Song of Songs. Quite what this book of often rather erotic love poetry is doing in the Bible has been a matter of debate for scholars through the centuries, but it certainly proved a rich source of inspiration for Renaissance composers. Some of the composers who set these texts, like Clemens, chose to interpret the text in a metaphorical way, perhaps as the love of Christ for his church, or depicting the immaculate nature of the Virgin Mary. However, many of the composers seem to delight in the opportunity to read the text in a rather more literal sense, incorporating madrigalian elements into church music. And one of those composers was Lattice, whose motet Veni, Dilecta Mi, we are about to sing. And this piece really depicts the excitement between the two lovers.
Thank you. In a few minutes' time, we're going to sing a rather suggestive motet by Palestrina, Oscillator May. Palestrina has a perhaps undeserved reputation for being a little bit academic or straight-laced, so it might come as a surprise that he wrote 29 settings of the Song of Songs. You'll be pleased to know we've managed to restrain ourselves to just two this evening. Before that, a pair of pieces with contrasting scorings. First of all, a sultry motet for lower voices by Nicholas Gombert. And after that, a rather intriguing piece for higher voices. It was published anonymously, but there's good evidence to suggest that it's by the composer Leonora d'Este, who was the daughter of none other than Lucrezia Borgia. Why was the piece published anonymously? Well, as a woman, a member of the nobility, and as a nun, she was three times over barred from being able to put her name to music, and so that's why, presumably, this piece was published anonymously.
Quam pulchra.
we finish our first half with one of our favourite settings of the Song of Songs texts. This is the Spanish composer Tomás Luis de Victoria's setting of Vardam et Chircuibo, which sets an extended passage of quite a dramatic narrative. It tells of a woman searching for her beloved through the city. And Victoria uses some of the latest compositional technical devices available to him, and also some of his most intense and lush harmonies to really tell the story in this work.
Thank you. Thank you. You may have noticed that the craze for setting texts from the Song of Songs largely passed by composers of the English Renaissance. But we have one setting for you. That is Tota Pulchra Es by Robert White. And the glorious soaring treble lines, the low bass lines that run throughout, and the rich texture suggest that it was written during the reign of Queen Mary as a celebration of England's return to Catholicism.
next two pieces demonstrate how some composers managed to create sublime portrayals of love by using some quite mathematical compositional techniques. In Dorore's motet, he writes a strict canon between three different voice parts, which he manages to maintain through the whole piece, even going through a transition from duple to triple time, which is very impressive. And in Guerrero's piece, which we'll sing before that, he uses a cantus firmus, which descends in pitch. It gets a step lower each time until the middle of the piece, where the pattern then reverses and it climbs back up to its original pitch by the end of the piece. It's sung by the second sopranos, and the text is "Come, Bride of Christ." So Guerrero is quite clear about his allegorical interpretation. But what's interesting is that all the other voice parts, which are singing the actual Song of Songs text itself, are much more lively and secular in style. So it's almost as if the rest of us are enjoying some earthly love, whilst the second sopranos are reminding us what we should be doing.
Sure. We finish our program tonight with two extremely vivacious polychoral works, with another four-part piece sandwiched in the middle, which is much more sultry. First up is Sebastian de Vivanco's setting of Veni Dilecte Mi, where he sets up plenty of flirtatious interplay between the two choirs. One suspects he was quite excited by the opportunity to set such an amorous text. We then move to a piece by the lesser-known Spanish composer Rodrigo de Ceballos. The text, Hortus Conclusus, literally means enclosed garden. And in the Renaissance and medieval art and music, this is to be found everywhere as an emblem for the Virgin Mary. And I think you can hear in this setting by Ceballos that his fervent devotion comes through the text. Then it's back to a multi-choir fireworks again with a setting by Hieronymus Praetorius. Again, that we heard the Tota Pulchra Est earlier. This is the same text, but altogether a more ambitious piece. It's set for three choirs this time, unlike the Vivanco, which is in two. And it's a sort of grandiose Venetian style. And you can imagine the brass playing along as we sing. There's, again, lots of interesting and exciting interplay between the three choirs.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. gentlemen, thank you very much for your warm and enthusiastic reception. It's, as always, a great pleasure for us to perform at Wigmore Hall. This is our 13th time here. We very much look forward to our next appearance, I think, in June. We have one more piece for you, a little bit of John Dowland. This is a setting of the Frog Galliard with text, "Now, oh now, I needs must part."